video will discuss about anterior superior alveolar nerve block. It is also called as infraorbital nerve block and can be asked as short answer. And this is the content list. Nerve anesthetized include ASA, MSA and infraorbital. That is terminal nerve branches. You know that maxillary nerve gives ASA and MSA in infraorbital canal. And after exiting from the infraorbital foramen, it gives the terminal branches. Three branches. Inferior palpebral, lateral nasal and superior labial. Right? So those are the nerves anesthetized. Then areas anesthetized includes the area supplied by these nerves. Right? You know that ASA is gives pulpal innervation, or it supplies maxillary teeth from central incisor to the canine region. Right? When MSA is absent, MSA only present in 28% of the cases. When it present, it gives supply to the maxillary premolars, that is bicuspids, and in some cases medial root of the maxillary first molar, mesiobuccal root. Right? So it is present in only 28% of the cases. Remaining 72% of the cases, the premolars and mesiobuccal root of the maxillary first molar is also supplied by the ASA. Right? So you can say that pulpal anesthesia is obtained from maxillary central incisor to the canine region or maxillary premolars and in some cases mesiobuccal root of maxillary first molar also. And due to the terminal branches, that is it supply lower eyelid and lateral part of the nose and upper lip, half of the upper lip. Those areas are the anesthetized. Then coming to the indications, you can write the indications when there is procedure on more than two of maxillary teeth up to the premolars. Right? In those cases, you can go for infraorbital nerve block. Otherwise, if there is contraindication to the supraperiosteal injection, that is infiltration, that means if there is periapical abscess, in those cases you can't go for supraperiosteal injection. In those cases, you can advise the nerve block. And in those cases, you have already given supraperiosteal injection, but that is not working, then in those cases also you can go for block. Then contraindications. There are no absolute contraindications, but in some cases, hemophilic cases like that, it is contraindicated. Then advantages, one injection, it provides a wide area of anesthesia and it is relatively safe. Then coming to the disadvantages. Disadvantages include, because of the fear of injury to the globe. That is the only disadvantage. It is relatively safer technique, but there is some fear with causing injury to the globe. Then positive aspiration, it is the 0.7%. Then coming to the technique. In technique, you have to definitely write targets and landmarks. So in technique, there are mainly two techniques. That is intraoral or extraoral. Generally, we commonly use intraoral technique only. In intraoral also, there are two techniques again. Bicuspid approach or central incisor approach. Central incisor approach, we are not using commonly. We commonly use bicuspid approach. So first we will discuss about the bicuspid intraoral approach. First we have to load the LA. 1.5 ml is enough. Or if you are using cartridge, you can use that. After that, proper patient and doctor position. That means for right or left infraorbital nerve blocks, you have to be in 10 o'clock position. And patient should be in a supine position with slightly neck extended, so that maxillary occlusal plane is 45 degree to the floor. Right? Those are the recommendations. Then the next step is, most important step is, you have to identify the infraorbital foramen. Infraorbital foramen. For anatomical purpose, you can see in this skull region. So, this is the orbit. This is nothing but the supraorbital notch, from which supratrochlear or suprafrontal nerves originate. Right? That is process. So this is the supraorbital notch and this is the infraorbital foramen and this is the mental foramen. All these three landmarks lie on a straight line, almost straight line. You can see in between there is pupil also. Supraorbital notch, pupil and infraorbital foramen and mental foramen. All lies on a straight line. So when you are identifying the infraorbital foramen, you have to ask the patient to look straight, in a straight goes, right? So from that, you can assume the proper position of the pupil. So you can identify the position of the pupil, then drop a vertical line from that pupil position to the infraorbital region. On that line, first you have to identify the infraorbital rim. This is the infraorbital rim, right? That is bony prominence below the eye. From that infraorbital rim, approximately 0.5 to 1 centimeter below, you can see a depression or notch. That is the exact location of the infraorbital foramen. If you apply pressure on that region for some time, obviously patient will complain of soreness. That is the indication of exact location of the infraorbital foramen. So you have to identify the infraorbital foramen. In that region, you have to place left hand thumb. This is the exact position, right? So after locating infraorbital foramen, say this is the infraorbital foramen. In that region, you have to place thumb, and with remaining fingers, or you can use only four finger, you have to retract the upper lip. You have to retract the upper lip and you have to expose the maxillary vestibule. In bicuspid approach, the next step is insert the needle at the height of the mucobuccal fold. So main landmarks comes here, infraorbital foramen or pupil, then mucobuccal fold. Because mucobuccal fold is the region where you are inserting your needle. In bicuspid approach, you have to insert immediately above the apex of the maxillary first premolar. You can use any teeth, but your target area should be infraorbital foramen. Right? So generally we commonly use first premolar tooth, and you have to insert at the height of the mucobuccal fold until you get a bone contact. That bone contact should be this region, that is slightly above the infraorbital foramen. So once you get the bone contact, you have to aspirate. If it is negative, then you have to go the deposition of the solution. 1.2 to 1.5 ml is enough. Right? So when you are depositing the solution, you can clearly feel the solution deposition under your thumb. That must be there. That is the clear cut indication that you are depositing solution in the correct region. Right? And while you are depositing, and after 1 minute of the procedure also, you should apply pressure with your thumb in that region. Right? So that the anesthesia will diffuse into the infraorbital foramen, and it will go into the infraorbital canal to anesthetize ASA and MSA. Without pressure, the solution will not sufficiently go into the infraorbital foramen. Our main region, if you want to anesthetize maxillary teeth, anesthesia should diffuse into the infraorbital foramen. If it will not diffuse, then you will get only anesthesia of the soft tissues like lower eyelid or lateral part of the nose or upper lip. That is not sufficient to do any procedure on the teeth. That is the importance of applying pressure so that solution can diffuse into the infraorbital foramen. Right? And after that, you have to remove the syringe and wait for 3 to 5 minutes, then ask for subjective symptoms. Subjective symptoms are due to the anesthesia of terminal branches. Patient will complain of anesthesia in lower eyelid part, lateral part of the nose and upper lip. And objectively, you have to confirm with instrumentation. If you are doing the procedure when there is no pain, that means ASA is blocked. Okay, this is the exact procedure. And this is bicuspid approach, intraoral technique. Then coming to the central incisor approach, nothing but same. Your needle aim or target is same, infraorbital foramen. The entire technique is same, infraorbital foramen is the our target area. But needle insertion, the way you insert the needle is different. You will insert the needle so that it will bisect the, this is the central incisor, same side central incisor. So it will bisect the mesio incisor angle and distal incisor angle of the central incisor. And needle insertion point is around at the mucovocal fold at the apex of the canine. And our target area is same, infraorbital foramen. If you want to see in this diagram, this is the central incisor, right? So I should insert syringe, mesio incisor angle of the central incisor, then distal gingival angle of the central incisor, and this is the canine. It should go from the apex of the canine like this. So obviously it will also lead to the infraorbital foramen. But why we are commonly using bicuspid approach, it is the shortest distance. It will provide shortest distance to the infraorbital foramen. If you use central incisor approach, then your needle insertion length should be more. If you use bicuspid, it will be less. That is why we are using commonly bicuspid approach. Okay, this is nothing but the central incisor approach. You have to, there is no need to write in the exam. Just if you mention, it is enough. Right, we are not using this, we are using this, and we are using this. Extraoral approach is nothing but, first procedure is same. You have to identify the infraorbital foramen. So directly in the infraorbital foramen region, you will insert needle in the skin. You have to prepare the skin with spirit. Then you will directly insert into the skin over the infraorbital foramen. And then you have to pass your needle in the infraorbital canal also in extraoral technique. Extraoral technique, the main indication is in trigeminal neuralgia management. If you want to go for alcohol neurolysis of trigeminal neuralgia management for infraorbital now, then you can use the extraoral technique. Because in extraoral technique, we are depositing solution directly into the infraorbital canal, not like intraoral technique. In intraoral technique, we are depending on the diffusion of the local anesthesia into the infraorbital canal. But in extraoral technique, we can directly deposit into the infraorbital canal so that there is better neurolysis. In alcohol injection technique, we'll use extraoral technique. That is the main indication of extraoral infraorbital nerve block. In complications, we have hematoma. If hematoma is there, if you have to apply the pressure, and you can apply the cold also. This is all about infraorbital nerve block. And I would like to thank Naveen Kumar Reddy, Tarun Kumar, and Bohini Vidya for their contribution towards channel memberships. If you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel.